Today's episode of Sessler Something is brought to you by AMD's new Elite Mobility A-Series processors. All right, this is the conclusion of the week of three announcements from Valve. Last time I talked about really only the first announcement, which was the Linux OS. And in the ensuing time, we have learned about the Steam Machines. Can I point out that is such a better name than Steambox? Steam Machine. It's a pun, that's good. And then the third prong was the controller. And I have to say, my initial reaction to the controller was abject horror. And then I kind of recalled my first reaction to the GameCube controller, which was also abject horror. And in retrospect, that is probably still one of my most favorite controllers I ever used. The use of haptic that's in it, the number of buttons utilizing both the bottom of the controller and the top of the controller, you can see that there is a lot of thought that has been put into that, and most likely some discussion with quite a few developers out there to ensure that this would meet their needs about how they would plan for a player to be interfacing with the game. Collectively, what you're really seeing is a very serious attempt by Valve to move into the living room. And I think it's something that people will have to be taking seriously. The only issue I still have with it is there's not all the there yet. We know that there's going to be a device, it's going to be 2014, and it has a controller. But in terms of those rallying points, those things to get you excited, naming the games, these AAA games that are going to be, that are being developed to be compatible with the Steam Machine, that's just kind of ephemera. That is just a promise that's out there. How these are performing, where the advantage is going to be, assuming that many of these games will also be available on the various consoles. They have everyone's attention. I think Valve now has to make those next big steps to keep on talking and keep people invigorated. The one advantage I have to say that Valve has, for a company that can be very aloof, they have also fostered such a fascinating community inside of Steam. There is more of a sense of back and forth than I think, even with the raucous fan bases behind Nintendo and Sony and Microsoft, that still really is sort of a top-down approach, and the hardcore fans of it just sort of amplify the messaging that comes out of the corporation. That community, if it's exploited right, could really be the differentiator for a Steam Machine, that sense that you're part of something bigger and that the box itself is an access point to that. But that will require Valve, who doesn't like to talk all the time, to probably talk a lot more than they normally do. The head-scratching thing I keep on asking myself is, why now? Without all those clear specifics, who's manufacturing the Steam Machines? Who are these AAA developers and publishers that are getting on board with it? What was the reason to have to go out now in this kind of unnecessarily dramatic fashion when they're just, you know, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday? And the only, you know, yes, Sony, Microsoft are going to be, you know, really getting all the mindshare very, very shortly, but also, where is Apple in all of this? You know, there's always been the lingering threat that they were going to do something similar, a set-top box, clearly a more walled-off garden than what Valve is proposing. And with Steve Jobs no longer around, that idea of moving into games seems a lot more viable inside of Apple. It almost seems to be a preemptive strike against something that we don't know. Do I think it's probably going to disrupt or cause trouble for Sony and Microsoft? I don't. But this is probably the strongest indicator that this other type of generation of, I guess, gaming console, which the Ouya and the GameStick are also part of, is something far more serious. And the question is, will it be an alternate, or could it be the next generation? And now we'd like to acknowledge our sponsor, AMD. Anyone who uses the same notebook for work and games knows that if you play, you may not have enough juice left over for the emails. That's where AMD's new line of A-Series Accelerated Processors, or APUs, come into play. They have been designed to provide the best combination of performance and mobility, where you don't have to sacrifice battery life and your on-the-go lifestyle in order to have a quality gaming experience. Keep an eye out for new notebooks like the Acer Aspire V5 with the AMD A4 APU that aim to deliver the touchscreen convenience of a tablet with a true notebook experience, all in a lightweight and ultra-thin design. Head to www.amd.com/APU to learn more. So the other thing I wanted to talk about, I've been playing Wind Waker HD. I'm of the camp that I think Wind Waker is the finest of all the Zeldas. I know it's probably one of the most divisive Zelda games. You know, it is the most divisive Zelda game out there because everyone agrees that the second Legend of Zelda really isn't all that fun. I've commented before that I thought it was a weird choice for the HD remake because the visuals of the original were so striking because they were so stylized. It is already the most expressive Zelda game out there because I think of the simplicity of the geometry and the faces. It actually can telegraph a lot more emotion than say Twilight Princess or Ocarina of Time. Once again, I'm thoroughly enjoying it once you get past those first 3 hours that every Zelda game has before you can get into all the good stuff. But it really brought to mind that question that does come up a lot about how games look. Zelda, the Wind Waker specifically, hasn't felt like it's aged because it was so stylized. It was such an act of deliberate aesthetic imagination when it first came out. It wasn't going for realistic, which some people claim Twilight Princess is and many, many other games really aim for. And that sense of realism really does seem to shorten that shelf life or that sense of awe that you get with so many video games because the technology can improve from year to year to year. Something that was so awesome back in 2006 can already start to look a little bit aged and long in the tooth by 2008. And that seems to be so unique to video games. I was thinking about like the Dutch masters, like Vermeer. These paintings that were done back in the 17th century still just blow my mind if I ever have the opportunity to stand in front of one of them and gaze at it. It was very realistic for the time. It was the result of, oil paints that were made available that just had so much more dynamic range in terms of representation. That hasn't aged, and it was trying to capture a sense of realism. Yet video games do the same, and it somehow makes them feel all the older.